All right, once we are in ZBrush after sending our character creator 5 base mesh, this part is always a lot of fun. We already have a solid starting point or a solid base mesh and even some really nice details coming from the normals that we kind of like baked during that process of transferring the CC5 character into ZBrush. So my plan is to use this base mesh to sculpt and detail the first layer of the sci-fi suit for this concept. And I do want to keep some of the details that came from the CC5 transfer around the face area, because I'm going to be able to take advantage of that and then just adjust the volumes. So what I'll do is I'll store a morph target with the layer details on. Then I'll bake that sculpting layer, so just bake layers. And then I'm going to switch the morph target and then use the morph brush to bring back those details only where I need them. And that is mainly around the head. Next, I'm going to reduce the definition of the anatomy a little bit. The idea with the suit is that it's going to be a tight suit, almost like a wetsuit, but it should still feel like there is a layer of material sitting on top of that body. So not just painted on the surface. So I'm going to smooth out some of the transitions between the muscles, softening the forms a little bit, and even suggesting where the neck seam of the suit could be. Nothing fancy, just a couple of clay buildup strokes to define that area. Now, using the standard brush, I can start roughly indicating some of the main wrinkles and the folds of the suit while smoothing the transitions to keep the surface clean. And since this model is sitting at around 14 million polygons, or a little bit more than that, in subdivision level 6, the regular smooth brush won't cut it. It won't be strong enough. So that's the reason why I'm switching to the Smooth Stronger, and this is a brush that comes with ZBrush. And I always say this, but there are plenty of ways of approaching this kind of sculpting or any type of sculpting really in ZBrush. But no matter what techniques you use, I think one of the most important things to have or to use are references. So I've collected a few examples of surfing suits or wetsuits and scuba diving suits as well, just to get a general sense of where the folds typically form. And again, these are just rough guidelines, but it helps. Later on, when I pose the character, I'll probably have to adjust some of the folds and based on how the material stretches and the compressions around the joints and that sort of thing. I'm also using the mask lasso to isolate some parts of the legs around the calves areas and, just inflate them a little bit just to suggest the compression that could happen if the character wears some boots, which again, that's the intention. And just to reiterate, this is just the blockout for now. I'll refine it later. Another tool that I really like for placing things like wrinkles and folds is the Geo brush. This is a brush that I created a while ago. It behaves very similarly to the damp standard brush, for example, but it gives you much more subtle and controlled creases and ridges. So I prefer to use that in this case. And you can grab it from the resource section in the Pablander Academy. Here, I'm alternating the stroke using the Alt key just to create both the raised areas and the indented folds, let's say. Now, for smaller, more generic wrinkles, I'm switching to a custom brush that I created called Compression Folds. This is part of my cloth and drapery pack, and this is available from the Academy resources. And it's just a quick way to speed up the process of adding believable material tension. Another really cool method is to generate a mesh in ZBrush and use Marvelous Designer to simulate that. As I mentioned, there are multiple ways of doing the same thing, so I'll just want to show you a different approach. I'm going to go ahead and duplicate the base mesh, and I'm gonna cut out the suit area. So basically removing the hands, the feet, and the head. And I did a quick serial measure just to simplify the geometry. I then exported both meshes, the base that CC5 gave me and the extra suit that I created in ZBrush, that extra geometry. And in Marvelous Designer, I imported the base from CC5 as the avatar, right? As the main character. And then the extra mesh that I created as the clothing. On a side note, a really handy feature from Marvelous Designer is that if you take your mesh and it already has UVs, you can use them or send them into Marvelous Designer as a pattern for the pieces so that they can be sewed together. So I can see all the pieces as a 2D pattern and I can sort of like sew them together. And once all the pieces are stitched together and simulated, you can see how powerful this workflow is. It gives you a more physically accurate folds and material behavior. I like to tweak the shrinkage weft and the warp values, basically the horizontal and the vertical compression of a specific garment or like a piece of that garment. And this allows you to control how many wrinkles appear in an area because you're adding length or width to the material without actually changing the size of it. Once you're happy with the simulation, export the mesh back into ZBrush for cleanup. I run a quick serial measure, project the details from history, and polish the surface so it's all nice quads instead of triangles. But here's the thing, and it is an important distinction from, other workflows. I could leave this suit as a separate mesh, just as it is, but I actually want to take advantage of the new CC5 feature, which is subdivision levels. That means I want the suit sculpted directly onto the base mesh, not as a separate object. So what I'll do is I'm going to project the simulation faults from the suit mesh onto the base mesh at the high subdivision level. That way, the wrinkles and the faults and all of that thing that we just simulated in Marvel Designer becomes part of the main geometry or the main base mesh that we are sculpting with. That's it. Once projected, you can go ahead and hide the suit or delete it if you want to. We're not going to need it. And continue refining those compression faults directly on the base mesh. And the reason for doing this will make a lot more sense once I send it back to CC5. So just bear with me. Now, let's focus on the face. I want to keep this character humanoid in a way, but push it slightly towards the more alien look. At first, the process of adjusting this is very, very standard. I start with a low subdivision level and focus on, let's say, blocking out the main facial shapes or the main volumes of the face. One thing that is very handy is that the base mesh from CC5 already has some really good polygroups for the face, which makes the, selecting and isolating parts or masking areas like the ears or around the eyes, that sort of thing, a lot easier, and it just makes it more comfortable to do the adjustment. Now, for refining and building up volumes quickly, I'm using another of my custom brushes called the Clean Build-Up Brush. It is similar to the Clay Build-Up Brush that comes with ZBrush, but this one allows you to create cleaner surface without, the heavy layering that the Clay Build-Up Brush does. And you might notice that I'm staying around subdivision level 2 or 3, where I can carve in more prominent creases and, in general, sharper cuts in the face. And if things read well and it feels solid at these lower levels, it will look really good inside CC5 too, even without the normal maps. And I'll show you all of that in a bit. Now, for smaller surface wrinkles, I also like using the brush from my Geiger and Beksinski pack, but you can achieve a very similar result with the damp standard brush. Just make sure that you push the C intensity value a little bit higher. Or you can also use the Geo brush as well that I mentioned before. Another really useful brush is the Form Soft. This is great for adjusting forms at a high subdivision level because it moves the volume while preserving the surface detail. All right, at this point, the sculpting and the general detailing of this base mesh are basically done. So let's do a quick test and send it back to CC5 and check how everything is coming through. I'm using the Character Creator GoC Plus plugin, which you can grab from the Realution website. It automates the entire process with a single click, which is really handy. And you'll notice the plugin has three switches for subdiv 0, 1, and 2. That is because Character Creator 5 can now handle subdivision levels up to 2. So I'm going to choose the subdivision 2. And since we haven't done anything with the textures or polypaint yet or any of that, I'm going to leave the polypaint to diffuse switch off. Now that's it. Let's go ahead and click on GoC and send it over. The GoC button specifically will export or send to CC5 the current selected subtool. And since we've only been working on the body, nothing else, that's basically all I need to send. Otherwise, we'll use the All button or the visible, but for now, we're just going to click on GoC and send just the base body. When the process switches back to Character Creator 5 and the GoC options window appear, you should see just the base mesh listed with the action set to update. I'm also going to enable Adjust Bones to Fit Morph, although we didn't make any major proportional changes, so it won't really matter that much. Let's go ahead and click on Update, and then you're good to go. All right, how cool is this? You can already see the main folds and the wrinkles in the suit showing through, and also, very nice volume definition in the face. And don't worry about the texture. Just ignore that for now. We're going to change that later on when we get to the texturing. And this is exactly what I was talking about earlier on. In the Modify window, under the Settings section, there is now a Sub-D level control. The viewport and the render sliders, they are both set at 2. And at the bottom right corner, you can also see this little text that says subdiv 2, meaning that we are viewing in real time, real geometry at subdivision 2. That's why the silhouette and the deformation looks really, really clean. So if you go ahead and switch back to subdivision level 1 or 0, just for comparison, it's a big difference, right? This is what it used to be, and now we have the ability to actually visualize more geometry. So definitely one of my absolute favorite additions to this new version of Character Creator. And that's it for this video. In the next one, we're going to start creating the armor pieces and the accessories, things like the shoulder pads, the boots, and other cool elements to enhance the look of our concept. I'll see you there.